Welcome back to the morning show here on Arise News. It's now time to take a look at news stories making headlines around the globe. Nigeria's President Muhammadu Buhari has met with the United States Treasury Secretary Stephen Mnuchin to request for additional capital from the U.S. development finance institutions to upgrade critical infrastructure in Nigeria. A statement yesterday by presidential spokesman Malam Garba Shehu said both men, who met on Wednesday in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, had positive discussions on investments in Nigeria under the new United States International Development Finance Corporation, which provides $60 billion for investments in developing nations. At the meeting held on the margins of the Future Investment Initiative, FII Forum, Shehu said Buhari told Mnuchin that Nigeria would leverage on this U.S. facility to address current challenges confronting its power sector, as well as a general upgrade of infrastructure. So to those who have questions or reservations about the frequency of foreign travels of President Buhari, at least we can point to some concrete developments, which we do hope bear fruit with our infrastructure. That really alarming revelation by the Minister of Finance that we need $100 billion a year to bridge that infrastructure deficit that we have, I'm sure it can't leave anybody's mind. It's so overwhelming, the amount of money that needs to be raised. Yeah. So I do hope that the U.S. does intervene in this sector.
Well, I mean, with the consistent gap between what is provided for capital expenditure and recurrent expenditure in the Nigerian budget annually, there is need, of course, for us to find ways, creative ways, of getting support or promoting partnership. That's one point. But whether, you know, that partnership, the form that it should take, should be in form of debt or in form of grants or in form of aid, is something that many Nigerian analysts are very critical about. But I think that the meeting with Stephen Mnuchin, the Treasury Secretary of the United States, on the sidelines of the event in Saudi Arabia, I think it is strategic for two reasons. One, the point I had made earlier about having to do a lot more in terms of provision of infrastructure, particularly in the power sector in Nigeria, and also, you know, in terms of the state of our roads. So that makes sense. And the U.S. International Finance Development has a budget of about $60 billion for developing countries. So I guess the plan by President Buhari is to see how he can engage the Americans, you know, in this direction. The other issue that was discussed with Stephen Mnuchin was also how to check illicit financial flows, particularly with regard to the financing of terrorism, and how to check that and get American support. And I think that also is quite strategic, and it makes sense. But the third point is the subtext of it. You see that Nigeria in recent times has been reaching out to Russia, to Japan, you know, to Saudi Arabia. Why we say that partnerships are important, in line even with the 17th goal of the Sustainable Development Goals? There's also geopolitics part of it. You know, the reach out to Africa by China and Russia and Japan, I'm not too sure, is something that the United States is always very happy about. I recall that, you know, during the Jonathan era, when President Jonathan was president of Nigeria, you know, we had tried to get a lot of support from the Americans for the fight against terrorism. But in many ways, the United States was very reluctant. When Israel, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu even wanted to support Nigeria, the Americans blocked it. They said there was, you know, there were some elements in the, you know, hardware that Israel was going to make available to Nigeria that the U.S. did not approve of. So they blocked it. You know, Nigeria went to Russia. They blocked it. At the end of the day, we finally were able to get support from Ukraine and Pakistan. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say that, yes, while reaching out to other countries, I think that President Buhari has been very diplomatic by also engaging the Americans, because the Americans don't take hostages. You know, if they see that, you know, you are reaching out to persons they do not, or countries they do not approve of, they may not disapprove of Saudi Arabia, there may be China, you know, there could be consequences diplomatically. So I think it's good that the guys in the Foreign Affairs Ministry have advised President Buhari appropriately to also continue to engage the United States, so that even when we are looking towards Russia or China, we do not jeopardize, you know, the interests that we have with the United States, either in terms of military collaboration or in terms of trade. Beyond all of this, you know, you see the Nigerian government doing a lot, you know, striking all these partnerships, signing agreements from Russia to Saudi Arabia to wherever. You know, follow-up is important, because that's one major omission in terms of our foreign policy process. We sign all these agreements, we make all these promises, but we do not have, in my view, you know, a very effective desk in the Foreign Affairs Ministry, in the various departments that ensure, you know, enough follow-through. And then of late, I've not heard about the Presidential Advisory Council on International Relations. There is a body like that of expert and experienced, you know, foreign policy persons, diplomats, who understand the major plans, the major fundamentals of Nigeria's foreign policy engagements. I hope that President Buhari would, you know, wake up that body and make more regular use of them, in line with many of the moves that he has been making on the foreign policy arena.
Absolutely. I think you hit the nail on the head with the geopolitics of it all and how we can't ignore that that does have a role to play. But I think the strategy here is also quite solid and also quite good, because he's looking for the U.S. to tap into two crucial areas for us right now, infrastructure. And like you said, it is absolutely shocking to everyone that now that we are aware of what our annual deficit basically is, we don't even know what the starting point is anymore. And then, of course, insecurity with checking into illicit financial flows. These are two areas right now that we do need help in, and we do need to key into strategic partnerships on. So hopefully it is followed up with, because I think last week we were speaking about how even with Russia, we had agreements from 2016 that weren't even talked about until the conference that happened this year. So following up is an issue, and it is something that the government has to take seriously if these strategic key partnerships are going to mean anything for us.
I didn't even think about this Presidential Council for Foreign Affairs, although there was a big event held this week relating to that, and the fact that there's really no cohesion, and all these experts and diplomats got together. Are you aware? That was earlier this week. But what I did think, because I read the article in This Day, and it referred to a chief or a head of terrorism funding in the U.S. government. And I wondered if this person has a Nigerian counterpart, if we have somebody just on that one issue. It's very important to properly delegate. Yeah. There needs to be somebody, because we've had this really alarming revelation that now foreign funding for terrorism has increased. It's now 50%. Do we have any desk dedicated to that as well? That's also something to look into.
Well, the guy in charge of terrorism, monitoring terrorism financing in the U.S., was part of the meeting,
yes,
with President Buhari in Saudi Arabia.
Yes. And there wasn't a Nigerian
But of course, it's the responsibility. You know that part of the delegation, of President Buhari's delegation, that is, included the National Security Advisor.
Yeah.
So that would be one of the functions of the Office of the National Security Advisor.
But there's somebody dedicated.
Yes, yeah. But you also have the Financial Intelligence Unit, whose job is not just domestic, but also tracking financial flows. And then you, of course, have the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission. It's not impossible that in those various departments you will have persons whose responsibility it is. But, you know, we have persons within the Nigerian system who are very strategic functions, who will never be identified publicly, you know, but the job is there. Even in our embassies, you know, all over the country, you have people who are embedded and who may never be publicly identified.
Just as long as we have them, that's my only concern. Now, as Nigeria braces up to the challenge of a looming industrial action in public-owned universities over implementation of the Integrated Payroll and Personnel Information System, IPIS, the Minister of Labor and Employment, Senator Chris Ngige, has insisted that no employee is at liberty to decide how to be paid, and urged the Academic Staff Union of Universities, ASU, to exercise caution in pushing their case. Ngige, who spoke to our sister outfit This Day, is quoted as saying, "I'm not aware of ASU's threat to go on strike. I also don't think it's a labor issue now. They're still discussing with their employers. But I don't think that it's proper that an employee should dictate to his employer how he's to be paid. What is important is that he should be paid." End of quote. Well, we're going to take a short break now on the news headlines, and when we come back, we'll have more. Stay with us. Welcome back to the morning show here on Arise News. So before we went on the break, we were talking or about to start discussing the continued impasse between ASUU and the federal government with regards to IPIS. They, the federal government, would, from their point of view, they have the right to dictate how they pay their employees. But ASUU maintains that certain peculiarities distinguish them from other civil servants, which include the way that the academia is structured, even their age of retirement and all kinds of issues. I don't see why all of that, those considerations cannot be sort of included in IPIS, and they have a sort of special arrangement within IPIS. Why insist on staying out of it?
Well, my position on this matter has been consistent, and that the ASUU, the Academic Staff Union of Universities, you know, has no case in this matter, and that they are misinterpreting the importance of the payroll and personnel information system. And I speak as someone who has been part of the university system, who is still a part of the university system, and who also served as a member of a governing council of a university. Now, ASUU is insisting that, you know, he's being subjected to blackmail by government. Our government is saying, you know, by refusing to be part of the payment system, you know, it's trying to promote corruption and lack of accountability and transparency. The truth of the matter, really, is that that IP system was introduced to ensure transparency and accountability and to check the existence of ghost workers. And it was introduced by the Jonathan administration. So it's not as if I'm talking about something that I don't know about. And the Buhari administration also insisting on it is in line with the Buhari administration's war against corruption. Now, I think, you know, again, ASUU itself is divided. The feedback we're getting from various divisions of ASUU, you know, is contradictory. Some support it, some do not support it. But I think that there's lack of understanding, there's lack of proper negotiation and communication, proper communication, maybe between government and ASUU. And I think government on its part should continue to explain what this is all about to ASUU. ASUU is talking about autonomy. I don't think this is an issue about autonomy. And I think that Ngige is right in saying that you can't dictate the method of payment to your employers, okay? And you know that our colleague Emmanuel Efene, this is what he also says. Maybe Ngige has been listening to Emmanuel Efene on the morning show, that a worker cannot dictate how he should be paid. What is important is that you are paid.
Yes.
ASUU is making a big issue out of, you know, academics on sabbatical. Academics who do who work as external examiners and assessors. Those are allowances. Now, I think a template can be worked out with regard to allowances, and that should not result in any kind of conflict. We all know that when academics go out as external examiners or external assessors, or they take on other assignments, they can be paid allowances, or when they do part-time lecturing in other places. But the basic salary that you earn at your place of employment, government is saying, look, you should be computerized. And when you go to enroll on an IPS, you bring your letter of employment. They will document your date of employment. If you are going to move out of the system, they will also document it. So that way you cannot be paid when you are not working. And government has said that anybody who does not meet the October 31 deadline, you know, will not receive any salary. And as you say, okay, there will be a no work, no pay strike, no pay, no work strike, and all that. I think ASUU leadership, the guy who is leading ASUU now, you know, was once my colleague. We started together. You know, I think that you know, he should ASUU should not heat up the polity on the issue of payment, of proper computerization of the payment system for all federal government workers. I don't support them on this one.
Absolutely, I don't support them either, because this is what we speak about when we say we take 10 steps forward or one step forward and then we're taking 10 steps back. This is a clear indication by the government to want to create a more transparent system that can hold people accountable and ensure that there are no ghost workers in the system, or that ghost workers are not receiving salary. And that is something that should be a welcoming development to anyone. So for ASUU to have serious kickbacks on this, yes, it does come to certain terms that regard the federal government to, and it means that they do have to start communicating a lot more than they already are. But I don't understand their grounds on this whatsoever. You cannot dictate how you are paid to your employer. If your employer wants to give you your salary in cash every month, your employer wants to give you your salary in cash every month, you're still getting your salary. Their duty is to make sure that you get your salary on time. It's not their duty to go about paying you how you want to be paid. So I don't understand what they're kicking at here, except for the fact that the government is trying to create a more transparent system, and we have to give credit to the government where due. This is a system that's been around for a while, and the government is using this system or wanting to use this system. We can't kick back on it.
Yes, I just hope they try. Let it just have a trial. The government has said that all the peculiarities that they harp on about will be taken into consideration. Let's have a trial before a protest.
Even
talking about a protest.
Honestly.
Now, the electoral body in Nigeria, INEC, says it has commenced prosecution of some of the ad hoc staff accused of involvement in electoral malpractices during the 2019 general election. Against the background of controversy that trailed the alleged electronic transmission of results at the last presidential election, INEC said it would like to make it clear that the results of the November 16th governorship elections in Bayelsa and Kogi states would be collated and transmitted manually, as dictated by the law. INEC's National Commissioner for Information, Voter Education and Publicity, Mr. Festus Okoye, also said the commission had barred some ad hoc staff from participating in the conduct of its elections, while some who participated in the 2019 general election would be facing prosecution. I think this is great news. And the more that this becomes like an established pattern, after elections come prosecutions, convictions, and hopefully jail time, it will sort of dissuade a lot of people. I did mention the other day there was one person being prosecuted at the moment in Gombe State for vote buying. Now INEC is, you know, turning the scrutiny to their own ad hoc staff. I think this is really encouraging.
Yeah.
Yes, I think so. I mean, the INEC chairman has consistently said that they are prepared, they are ready to conduct elections in Kogi and Bayelsa states, the governorship elections scheduled for November 16. And Festus Okoye, who is a commissioner in charge of voter education and information, has also reassured us. And he was the one that even made this point that, you know, some of the ad hoc staff have been barred from taking part in, you know, elections, and that some are already being prosecuted. And then, of course, we've been told that, you know, in terms of preparation, in Kogi State alone, I think they have about 2,400 polling booths, 1.6 million registered voters. But when you look at the number of policemen who have been deployed, 20,000 policemen for Kogi State alone, you know, 10,000 civil defense officials for Kogi State alone. Nobody knows the number of soldiers that will be deployed, you know, either in Bayelsa or in Kogi State. In Bayelsa State, you have 45 political parties taking part. In Kogi State, you have 24 political parties participating in this gubernatorial election. So they really have a serious work, you know, ahead of them. And it's good that they are reassuring us that, you know, persons, ad hoc staff that may be guilty of corrupting the process will not even be allowed to go near it. But beyond all of this, you know, the civil society situation room meeting that was held, one major issue that came out of it is that INEC and the various security agencies that will be deployed will need to do a lot to check vote buying and the harassment and intimidation of voters on November 16. And we can only say to INEC that, you know, this is another major test for it. INEC says it has held a number of, conferences, meetings, review meetings after the general elections. We would like to see whether INEC and its various collaborators and other stakeholders have learned the appropriate lessons from the conduct of the 2019 general elections. But beyond all of this, in terms of the prosecution of electoral offenders, we still have on the table in Nigeria the proposal that there should be an electoral offenders commission, you know, or tribunal, as it is called, which can expeditiously deal with cases of electoral offenses, you know, to check criminal conduct and the violation of the people's right to choose.
Absolutely. Very welcoming development, honestly. I like this. This is the kind of thing we like to see coming out from INEC. There's a lot of scrutiny that we put towards the institution for many reasons. So when you hear things like this and you know that they are actually taking matters into their own hands, it can only be welcoming. I'm happy to hear this.
And hopefully we'll give any ad hoc staff of INEC planning any shenanigans on November 16th. We'll give them pause before they even contemplate such a thing. Still in Nigeria, the Lagos State Police Command says it has rescued 15 inmates from an illegal prayer house in Ijagun Isheri area of the state. Bala Elkana, the state police public relations officer who confirmed the arrest, said they met some of the inmates in chains at the prayer house known as Blessings of Goodness Healing Church. The police officer said some of the inmates were brought by their family to seek spiritual help from mental illness and other diseases. Investigation is still ongoing, and the police are working closely with other agencies of government to provide adequate medical attention and shelter to the victims. This is coming 6 days after 108 inmates were rescued at a rehabilitation center known as Sumuratu Mumin Arabic Center in Gar Odota in Ilorin, Kwara State. Imagine the nerve, healing, blessing healing center, and you're chaining people to the ground. I mean, this just speaks volumes. It's not even a religious issue like people tend to, the more, you know, simple-minded of us tend to try and make it. It's a human issue. You're either a good person or you're a bad person. Mm-hmm. How do people entrust you with their children and their wards who are suffering from mental illness, addiction, or something else, and you chain them like animals for years on end? And those parents as well, and guardians, who also abdicate responsibility. After you've dropped off your child award, no, you don't even cast a backward glance. You don't go and check how they've been treated. And I'm sure at this point, they're all like, oh, what a shock. They were treated so badly.
It's baffling.
Well, Prophet Sunday Joseph Ojo, who runs this blessing center, as you call it, says he's been running it since 1986. So this is something that has been going on for long. We have discussed this subject repeatedly on this program. First, when it was discovered that about 147 persons were in the same situation in Kaduna State, and then another, about 147 of them, and then another in Zaria, and then there was a case in Katsina, then there was a case in Ilorin. You find people running these illegal, unregistered rehabilitation centers where persons are dehumanized. The special point raised by this is about mental health and the structures available in Nigeria for managing mental health.
This is the question. Well, that's all on News Headlines.